I have loved coffee for years. And as it is the world's most popular drink with over 400 billion cups consumed every year, there is a good chance that you do too. Funnily enough, in spite of its place in our culture, it is something that most of us know very little about. Where does it come from? How is it produced? And what makes a good cup of coffee? Firstly, to help understand where coffee comes from, you need to know a little bit about the history of coffee. Coffee was first discovered around 1,000 years ago in eastern Africa, in an area we know today as Ethiopia. The story goes that goats similar to this one used to eat coffee berries. One day a goat herder by the name of Caldi observed his goats acting unusually frisky after eating them. Curious about this phenomenon, Caldi tried eating the berries himself. He found that these berries gave him a renewed energy. The news of this energy-laden fruit quickly spread throughout the region. From Ethiopia, coffee spread to Yemen, Arabia, and Egypt, and quickly entered popular daily life. From the Middle East, coffee travelled to Turkey, where coffee beans were roasted for the first time over open fires. The roasted beans were crushed and then boiled in water, creating a crude version of the beverage we enjoy today. In the late 1500s, coffee moved into Europe, which heralded the introduction of the new beverage into Western life and custom. However, this new beverage fell under harsh criticism from the Catholic Church. Many felt Pope Clement VII should ban coffee, calling it the drink of the devil. To their surprise, the Pope, already a coffee drinker, blessed coffee, declaring it a truly Christian beverage. From the 1700s onwards, coffee found its way around most of the world. From the history, you can see where it has travelled over time, but where does it come from today? I'm here at Mojo Cafe with Hayden Jensen. Hayden, do you mind explaining a little bit about where in the world coffee is harvested and a little bit about the harvesting process that it goes through?
This, four main areas that coffee is grown in, Central America, South America, Indonesia and Africa. It starts out as a similar to a cherry on a fruit tree. It's processed by hand, generally hand picked. There are a few places that do machine picking, but that raises the cost of coffee. And there's two processes that you get the bean from the fruit. The first being dry processing, and the second is a wet process. With the dry, all the fruit's laid out and allowed to dry naturally, raked and turned, and then the beans separate from the fruit. With the wet process, they're laid out in a pool of water, allowed to ferment and rot, and then the beans are separated from the fruit that way. From there, it's all packed, bagged, sacked up, and sent around the world.
In 1640, the first coffee shop opened in Venice. Coffee houses spread quickly across Europe and became centres for intellectual exchange. Many great minds of Europe used coffee as a springboard to heighten thought and creativity. Today, cafes are everywhere selling this lovely brew, with Wellington supposedly having the most cafes per head of population in the world. I'm here at Le Fare, one of my favourite cafes, with Paul Coburn. Paul, just how are the raw coffee beans processed?
Well, simply put, you take green beans and you add heat. And as they suspend the sacks of coffee over the silo, that silo allows the conveyance of the green coffee to a top silo that's situated above the coffee roaster itself. The way that silo works is there's a fan behind it that pushes air through, the green beans sort of like flow up that curved pipe and are stored in readiness for the next roast. The roaster, when the barrel is actually at the right temperature, generally it's about 200 to 215 degrees, depending on what type of coffee, because you have to remember that different coffees have got respond differently to heat. When the barrel is up to temperature, they can sort of release the green beans from that top silo, allowing them to, you know, get into the roaster itself. The roaster is essentially like a large tumble dryer or a concrete mixer, where it has little fins on the inside of the barrel that, as the barrel tumbles, it sort of keeps the coffees in motion, keeps them off the side walls of the, so you get a decent and full and even roast. The initial stages of the roaster basically to drive moisture away out of the bean and allow the bean to, you know, swell. Then the temperature can be increased to actually sort of like start the development of the, you know, coffee flavour compounds, if you will. You know, it's about two-thirds of the way through the roast, the first crack occurs, which is the point in which the beans sort of swell and burst, exposing more of the meat, or at least more, you know, more surface area to the heat. Then from then it gets, from that point on to the final, you know, stages of the roast, the critical phase. Basically, we're trying to the beans will crack again after about like, you know, 10 or 12 minutes, depending on the temperature, the environment, and the green beans themselves. But the trick is to sort of stop them before, because at the second crack, that's when carbonisation sets in, that's where the beans start getting burnt. So you've got to sort of pull the coffee out immediately prior to it, cool it as quickly as possible using the large cooling tray just to stop the cook. And then from there, it's just, you know, packaging.
So now we know the origin of coffee and where and how it is produced and processed. But what makes a good coffee?
Decent hand, or at least a sort of sound technique. You need to know the system, and you need to know, be aware of the rules, follow the rules, and get the best out of all three. That is the machine, the coffee, and you as the operator. You know, there are three pretty fundamental rules that can be applied to any method of brewing coffee, whether it's your plunger at home, or, you know, your stovetop, moka pot, or your espresso.
Well, there's a lot of factors that go into making a perfect cup of coffee, but what separates a good cup of coffee from a great cup of coffee is definitely the love. You'll find any trained monkey can make a good cup of coffee because it relies on a set of factors. You need a correct water temperature, fresh coffee beans, the right sort of coffee beans. You know, a lot of things affect the way coffee is made. So, yeah, I mean, anybody could make a good cup of coffee, but unless you've really put a lot of attention into it and a lot of care, it makes an excellent cup.
The taste for coffee is now filtered into many cultures around the world. Nowadays, the problem is not finding where to get a coffee from, as we are spoilt for choice not only in the cafes that we can visit, but also in the numerous methods of creating different types of coffee. Should I have a latte? Or an espresso? Or maybe a mochaccino? Good coffee, strong coffee.